So Stephen Cooke is an assistant professor of biology and environmental science at Carleton University in Ottawa. He completed his education in both Canada and the U.S. He has previously held several positions in the student subsection of the AFS, and currently he is chair of the AFS publication overview committee. He also co-wrote the chapter on employment in Canada in the AFS book on fisheries and employment in North America.
Alright, so a few days ago I was lobbying via email that we didn't use presentations and then we didn't use PowerPoint, so I don't know, I was feeling like I'd be the only one with that one. I think everybody else said they were going to, and then, so.
I said I wasn't going to.
You sent me an email anyway, so now I sort of shafted Donna, and so now I have a beautiful presentation. Today I'm going to talk about perspectives on postgraduate education and academic positions for young fisheries professionals in Canada. I guess you don't have to be young. A couple things, again, plug for the book. I say it's $12 USD. I don't know what it really is. That's what it used to cost. So it's based on a chapter in there by myself and Scott Pinch, and then also several students in my lab, as well as Andrew at the back from the University of Illinois, wrote a fisheries student angle article that contrasts grad school opportunities in Canada versus the U.S. So there's some subtle differences, and I'll touch on some of those as well. So I'm not sure whether you realize, but up here we sort of, you know, we're alternating with sort of boys and girls, and we're also trying to have somebody from Canada and the U.S. that covers each sector. So very intentional. Fisheries are diverse. We're trying to represent that for you today. So what I want to do is make sure I hit on those differences between Canada and the U.S. Why should there be lots of fisheries jobs in Canada? And many of these things also apply to the U.S. We're surrounded by three oceans. We have an awful lot of coastline. 25% of the world's fresh water. More than 2 million freshwater lakes. Covering 7% of our landmass. Lots of fishing vessels. 3.6 million recreational anglers. There are many more of those in the U.S. We have diversity in landscape, people, fish, and fisheries. And of course, lots of problems and lots of challenges. Just a few comments on grad school. Start with grad school, then move on to academic positions. There are lots of opportunities these days, or at least that's the situation in Canada. We as professors are competing with each other for you. I don't really think of it the other way around. As long as you are a good student and are active, and I'll tell you the kinds of things we're looking for, then it's usually us competing for you. Most of the good students have multiple offers from different institutions, and we try and steal you from each other. So it's a good time to be a student looking for an academic position, I would submit. The three things that I tend to look for, and this is Tony Farrell, who was one of my postdoc mentors, told me this. The three P's: promise, so the idea that what you could be, sort of your potential, your passions, you need to be passionate about something, and of course you need to be productive, so you need to actually show that you can accomplish things and do it in a timely manner, follow through, and so on. Just some differences between the U.S. and Canada. Entrance requirements are somewhat different. In Canada, GREs are meaningless, and if you're Canadian and decide to go to the U.S., you need to find a place to write the GREs, which is a bit of a challenge. If you're from the U.S. and communicating with a professor in Canada, they don't care about your GREs, so don't even bother sending that info along. Publications in Canada, publications tend to be very important. Oftentimes, undergraduates for their thesis project, they're doing publication quality work, and that's something that is not essential, but I would say that most of the people entering master's positions in Canada do have either their name on a publication, may not be first author, but they've been involved in the publication process. The availability of merit-based scholarships from the government varies quite a bit. In the U.S., you have NSF. There's very few of those fellowships. In Canada, we have a lot. We have something called NSERC, which stands for the Natural Sciences and Engineering Research Council. It supports an awful lot of students across Canada. On top of that, we have provincial scholarships. For example, the Ontario Graduate Scholarship that people can apply for. I would say two-thirds of the students in my lab are supported by these programs. That means when they come to me, They show up and they say, hey, I have money to pay for my entire grad program. You know, do you want to take me? It's like, okay. So on top of that, bringing in those fellowships shows that you're sort of, you know, at a certain academic level. In the U.S., having spent some time there, it was really difficult to find such application or such similar programs. So another little bit of a difference. If you're in Canada, sometimes you can take these abroad. So I did that. I took my Canadian money and went down. I went to Canadian scholarship and took it to the University of Illinois. It is, however, very difficult for U.S. citizens or people from anywhere else other than Canada to secure a lot of these internal ones. So I have an American student in my lab right now. He's fantastic. Applies for lots of things or tries to apply for things and gets shut down at the application process level when he reads and finds out that he's not eligible. That seems to be reasonably consistent though in Canada or the U.S. Usually your federal governments tend to restrict these scholarships to their own peoples, if you will. Institutional organization also differs. In Canada, you'd be hard-pressed to find any department or any program with the word fish in it. There are a few exceptions, but we tend to be more generalist in nature, so we have biology departments, integrative biology, natural resources, geography. There are sometimes programs such as natural resource conservation or conservation biology, but there's very few places with the word fish in the title. There tends to be one or two fishing profs at every university in Canada. That seems to be the model. There are, again, a few exceptions. University of British Columbia is probably the biggest exception. In Canada, there are fewer examples of on-campus allied agencies. So what I mean by that is something like Dr. Parrish will discuss. She works for the co-op unit. So that's a federal agency. She actually works on campus with the university. I did my PhD in Illinois at the Illinois Natural History Survey, which was on campus. It's really difficult to find those kinds of relationships in Canada. They do exist. They're few and far between. However, in Canada, it's very, very common to have adjunct professors that aren't on campus but can be on committees. So Karen and Jack, for example, both have several appointments at different universities, even though they might be